get the topic, you know, interpersonal skills, let me give you a brief up of why soft skills has become very important for all kinds of professions, right? The very recent research talks about the importance of soft skills. Hayes research has come up with a beautiful survey and it says 77% of the professionals get a job if and only they have people skills. So when I use the word people skills here, I am referring to nothing but soft skills. In fact, we all know as teachers, I belong to the tribe of teachers definitely. So I would rather say that all of us are very much in sync of the fact that employability skills falls into the category of soft skills. You might be a technical expert, you might be a domain knowledge expert, you might be a geek, you might be a gold medalist whatsoever, but then if you do not have soft skills, you cannot survive. That's a fact of life, right? Now, if you, look back, people time and again have stressed on this. To give you an adage, you know, of Dr. Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan, he says that man has learned to fly like birds in the air, man has learned to swim like fish in water, but unfortunately man has not learned to live like a man on earth. How true? How true? We call ourselves as a tribe of professionals, intellectuals, we are in the process of learning, giving knowledge, imparting knowledge and all that, but at times, you know, we know that somewhere or the other when we do a bit of self-introspection, we feel that we are not good in terms of our soft skills. I mean, I'm not here referring to soft skill as communication alone. Because soft skill, when you refer to this particular word, it's an umbrella term. It consists of a lot of things, attitude, personality, behavior, so many factors. It encompasses a lot of attributes, right? So we have identified for this 1 hour session only one particular module, which is called as interpersonal skills. Now, this is just like the tip of an iceberg. You know, there are a lot of things. If you look back into the component of behavioral science per se, it talks on all this component of communication, personality, motivation, learning, attitude, so on and so forth. So today, let us have 1 hour session on only interpersonal skills. Okay. So before we run through this PPTs and all that, now let us have a very, very proactive and interactive session. What I would suggest, because I being in a corporate training hall, I always wish people talk more rather than be. You know, just because we are on the other side of the fence, it doesn't mean that we have to. We initiate the process, but then it should be you who should be giving a lot of inputs to us, right? Because it becomes a two-sided affair, right? So before we get into the component of interpersonal skills, just let me ask you a question, a simple question. What do you mean by this term interpersonal skills? I mean, I don't want a definition, I don't want anything. You know, you're all teachers, you're well-versed, you're all walking, talking encyclopedia, no doubt about that. What do you understand, basically? Anybody out there, anything, it can be any kind of answer.
Face-to-face communication.
Okay, interaction, communication, alright. What else?
Exchange of ideas.
Exchange of ideas, okay.
Your ability to communicate.
Ability to communicate, okay.
Presenting yourself.
Presenting yourself, alright.
Sharing information.
Sharing information, okay. So let me tell you, interpersonal, right? Interpersonal is interaction that happens between two or more people, okay? It need not be communication. See, it can be verbal, non-verbal or vocal. That's the beauty of interpersonal skills. We put it in layman terms as people skill. And let me tell you that you do not require an MBA or a PhD to have this people skill. Even a simple vendor who's seated there selling greengrocer, you know, who sells tomatoes or vegetables or potatoes whatsoever, might have a better people skill compared to us. It's tactical diplomacy. Building synergy, 2 plus 2 need not be 4, it can be 5 also. The way you tackle an issue, the way you resolve a problem, the way you ease out conflicts, all this falls under the category of interpersonal. So interpersonal is not just fine-tuned to the communication pattern alone. It is more related with your behavioral pattern. It can be verbal, it can be non-verbal, it can be vocal. Look at that. Okay, it's a behavioral pattern. And second question, to have a behavioral pattern, do we require a post-graduation and a PhD, friends? We do not require, let me tell you. Just because we are PhD doesn't mean that we are very good in soft skills or we are very good in interpersonal. It's not so. It's more into our way of thinking, our mindset, our attitude, our personality, so on and so forth. Now, that is where the behavioral science has come into the picture and stressed and emphasized on the fact that irrespective of who a professional is, he or she should be time and again reminded of the importance of soft skills, because we are dealing with human beings. We are not dealing with equipment alone. See, if something is not working here today, we can easily change that component. Correct? We can replace it. Not a big deal. We are in a technological world. Right? But here we are dealing with emotions. All of us come here, have walked into this room with a bag and baggage of emotions. We cannot get isolated with emotions. We are a part and parcel of emotions. No matter what kind of science and technology, what kind of interventions are applied, still we remain same. Human beings are incomplete without the component of emotions. Right? So that is where the importance of people skills comes into the picture. Now, we said interpersonal skills are more related with the interaction you have with people. Right? My second question is, do you start interacting with a person very nicely the moment you meet him or her, the first context itself? It depends. Sometimes we might start in a very nice fashion and then we might feel that, oh, this person is not my wavelength. I am not able to adjust with this person. So, I don't think I can make a strong rapport with him or her. Right? Sometimes you feel that we get on, I'm so comfortable with the other person, we get on like a house on fire. I feel so nice when I am in the company of this person. We do feel so, irrespective of who he or she is. Correct? Now, what I'm trying to drive in here is, interpersonal skills are a byproduct of intrapersonal. I-N-T-R-A, I-N-T-E-R. Both are two different words. Poles of, two different poles, two different sides of a single coin. I-N-T-R-A, intrapersonal skills are more related to internal, inner engineering, emotions, attitude, feeling, thoughts, etc. I'm sure, just giving an example at this point in time, when you're seated here on a Saturday, you might be feeling, why Saturday after all? No other better work for these guys. Why are they calling us to sit here in the training center on a Saturday? I'm telling you, this is a human tendency. Especially ladies, we just want to go back home and dash there. Enough. We have done a week's work and we all have a family, children. We all know we are multitasking all the time. Correct? So we just want to be left alone on a weekend. Again, I don't want to become a student there, seated in the classroom and just listen to somebody talking on something. Not interested at all. Right? So there are a lot of emotions internal. I'm sure that none of you seated here can say that, no, I was eagerly looking forward to listen to you. Definitely not. It's like, it's other way around. How I wish this particular session was cancelled. Human tendency, intrapersonal, the emotions, the thought. You cannot DNA, you just cannot isolate it. It's a part and parcel, they're just like a DNA. Irrespective of what you are all teaching, into a teaching profession, but still, you wouldn't yearn and you wouldn't feel that I should be a part of a Saturday session. Definitely not. Come on, don't fool people. Right? So intrapersonal skills are very much there. You cannot be alienate. And let me give you another example. I'm trying to link intrapersonal to interpersonal. I'm not trying to tell you that interpersonal just blooms and blossoms one fine morning. No. It is not so. According to behavioral science, interpersonal is a byproduct of intrapersonal. Intra is more related to one's own beliefs, thoughts, emotions, etc. And you cannot separate them. You're always a part and parcel to it. So when I say you, all of us even here, irrespective of what kind of background we have, are functioning on intra. Always, we have a lot of thoughts within us. Even at this point in time, when will the session end? Okay, at what time will I reach my home front? What to cook tonight? Okay, I think my son or my daughter has exams on Monday. When should I coach her up, or when should I sit her for, take her for a tuition? So many other thoughts. Right? So intrapersonal skills are very, very important. The point what I'm trying to drive in is, create a mindfulness. What do you mean by the term mindfulness? It's a new word, not very new, but then definitely have been there in organizational behavior for quite some time, human resource, Mindfulness is the latest word research scholars are using to create, positive impact of behavioral skills. What do you mean by the term mindfulness? Mindfulness meaning a conscious, deliberate way of thinking. Because intrapersonal is more on thoughts, feelings and thinking. So you should create more of mindfulness. What should I think? How should I think? What kind of thoughts should come into my mind? Please do a bit of research on mindfulness. You get scores and scores of research scholarly paper. Beautiful word. It has both connotation and denotation. What you think, how you think. Make a deliberate, conscious approach of thinking. Inculcate positive thinking. Have a control of your intrapersonal skills. That is where you become fine-tuned to develop interpersonal skills. Interpersonal skills is not, lo and behold, here you've been given a pill of interpersonal skills. You pop it and you become perfect while dealing with people. It is not so. It comes as a byproduct of intrapersonal. So when we talk about intrapersonal, it's high time you refer to mindfulness. Right? So we say interpersonal skills are more how you deal with people. It can be your seniors, your subordinates, your students, whosoever. And I'm trying to tell you that interpersonal skill is a byproduct of intrapersonal. Now, intrapersonal skills plus interpersonal skills is equal to self-awareness. Self-awareness is a beautiful word. What do you mean by self-awareness? Knowing oneself. How many of us can say that I know myself completely? Is it so? I don't know. I'm just asking you. How many of you can say that I think I know me better than anybody else? Okay. If somebody says out here, I think I know me better than anybody else, I'll just give you an example. There is a slight tremor, earthquake, okay? 30 seconds, everything moved, shaked, and you all fell down. You got up, and in the process, some of you would have screamed, some of you would have really got panic-stricken, some of you would have become a bundle of nerves, and later on you realize, oh my God, there was a tremor in Bangalore, earthquake in Bangalore. I never thought I'd get so frozen. I always thought that I am little courageous. I never knew that I would be totally frozen if some calamities happen. What I'm trying to tell you is there are different phases in life which brings out different aspects of an individual. And we cannot completely say that I know myself. That is why Aristotle said at the beginning, know thyself. First of all, try to know yourself, which is not that easy. Every day we are learning so many things. I'll give you another common example. See, we talk about the importance of communication, especially language. When we refer to placements, we say that, okay, communication is considered to be very important and the companies are coming in, they will ensure that people speak better English, right? Now, friends, please understand, communication is not that one fine morning they wake up and start speaking fluent English. It's been there. It's been, a part and parcel of their learning, their upcoming, the way they grew up, what kind of teachers they had, whether they taught English or Hinglish, whatsoever, right? Now, considering the same example, if you have had children at home, children in metropolitan and cosmopolitan cities, especially Bangalore, speak impeccable English. The children who are going to kindergarten schools, who are hardly 3, 3.5 years, speak better English than some of us. Some of us, I'm talking 40, 45, 50 years old. Why? Any idea? Why? Listening. They listen unbiased. Listening is also a byproduct of intrapersonal skills. Very important. We do not listen. Why we do not listen as adults? Because we have our own stereotypes, prejudices, biases, discrimination. We evaluate, we judge, we jump into conclusion. He did for nothing. I don't like her at all. I cannot stand that person. Right? So we are all totally cemented, glued mindset. Whereas children, they are like the freshly ground cement. They can listen without any bias. So that's the reason the language becomes, very easy for them. You would have seen, if you have had any kids at home, enacting as a teacher, they just pick a piece of cloth and put it on their body and try to act as if they are a teacher. The English they learned, the language they, they use simultaneously. Sometimes they pick up bad words, abusive language also. They might not know the meaning, but still, it's a trendsetter. People are using it, so they use it. Why? Listening. There's a difference between the word listening and hearing. If you look at the word listen, L-I-S-T-E-N, there is also a word silent embedded in it, S-I-L-E-N-T. They're silent inwardly, they're silent outwardly, they can just listen. Put a heart and soul and just listen. Okay, listening is very important for interpersonal skills. We do not listen. Why we do not listen? Because we have our own biases. We live in our own world. Frogs in the bed. We can't do anything. We are adults. Right? So when I refer to interpersonal skills, they are connected with so many other attributes. Intrapersonal. Okay? When we refer to intrapersonal skills, we talk about personality, we talk about attitude, we talk about behavioral patterns, we talk about words we use, vocal influence, non-verbal, verbal, etc. And when we refer to intrapersonal, we also talk about something called as mindfulness. You know, we do not know what is mindfulness. Mindfulness is very important to fine-tune our intrapersonal skills. Intrapersonal plus interpersonal gives self-awareness. And self-awareness is not a complete paradigm. It's not a complete continuum. It's you know, input which you are receiving every day in and day out, in every experience. So when we refer to this word, you know, self-awareness, we refer to a few things like, what do we know about ourselves? How do we deal with people? You would have heard people saying that, if I get angry, you know, I don't know what I'll do. I cannot tolerate this for a long time. You would have heard people saying that. So, they do not have the self-awareness. They themselves have lost control. So, self-awareness leads to few things like self-management, self-regulation, self-motivation, empathy. Look at that. Each word by and large itself is an experience. It's a learning. And we are not complete. Let me tell you, irrespective of what our age is, what our qualifications are, whatsoever. Alright. Second question. Why is people skills important? Why do you think as teachers out here, interpersonal skills are important? Now you tell me. I have given you a brief prelude of interpersonal skills. Now you tell me why this word is important? Why this attribute is important for us teaching fraternity? Why? Anybody out there, please feel free to talk. Why is it important? So teachers, we put ourselves on a pedestal and we give instructions to the students. Hey, switch off the mobile phones, listen to me, take notes. Why interpersonal skills are important for us?
Because each student is not the same.
Okay.
So we need to, we cannot use the same yardstick to everyone.
Okay.
To communicate with the student easily.
Okay. It takes time for you to communicate. It depends on, okay. What else?
Whatever we want to express to the student, it should reach them in the best way.
Okay.
In drilling them properly.
Drilling them. Okay. And what is your background, by the way? Engineering faculty.
We have a language.
Okay. So drilling them. Okay. Well, sometimes it's required. Yes. As she said, you know, we can't have the same yardsticks. Today it's a mix and match of different kinds of people. You know, introverts, extroverts, ambiverts, perverts. Any kind of, you know, psychologically disturbed candidates also might be seated in your class. We really do not, we can't use the same yardstick. Alright, so for us, let us understand the fact that it's very, very important for teachers to have a very strong people skills, because we cannot expect them to raise to our level. We have to go to their level. That's very important. Unfortunately, what happens is, I'm telling you a, you know, stark reality, and sometimes reality bites. The more qualified we are, the more educational credentials we get, we have a streak of arrogance somewhere or the other. Let us accept the fact. You know, we feel that we are all-knowing, all-pervading, walking, talking encyclopedias. And if somebody tries to, you know, show that chip on the shoulder kind of attitude, we try to put them down by either deducting their marks in the internal examinations or whatsoever, or we take our own, I'm not generalizing the statement, I'm just trying to tell you that as a individual, I'm not talking about a profession, as an individual, we always portray this kind of attributes, whether we accept it or not. You know, somewhere or the other, it teaches us. How can the student behave like this? I know how to cut his tail. I know what to do with him. Some might express it explicitly, some might not express it, but do the needful through a submerged agenda. It all depends. And I can openly challenge that none of us will take in for granted a streak of arrogance or an arrogant behavior in the classrooms. We can't digest it, first of all. Why? Because we feel that how can she behave like this? How can he behave like this? I cannot take it. What does he think of himself? Right? Yes, we should work on the discipline and decorum part when we talk about Gen Y. However, let me tell you one thing. Today's research says that tomorrow's workforce will consist of Gen Y. Gen Y, our students. Tomorrow's workforce will be our Gen Y. And it's going to be a big challenge for us because these are the guys who are living on a diet of social media. They have a diet called as Facebook, LinkedIn, Orkut, whatsoever. They are a byproduct of wired generation. They have limited competencies and skill sets. They are very good technologically, but not very good in social skills. So what is social skills? Attitude. They definitely do not know what is positive attitude. Today, company believes that, any organization for that matter, has a dictum that hire for attitude and train them on skills. Don't bother about their credentials, whether the CGPA is 8.9 or 9.5, that's not a credential. The credential is, does the candidate display a positive attitude? If yes, hire him, because definitely you can train them on skills. Learning and development is a part and parcel of an organization. That's what today's organization believes in. And if we are dealing with this kind of people who are totally a byproduct of technology, we require a strong sense of people skills. We cannot apply the same yardstick. And let me tell you today, punishments and reinforcements have definitely taken a backseat. You cannot enforce punishments. You have seen a lot of examples happening in and around. The student was insulted in the class. He goes back and jumps from his building and writes a suicide note saying that the teacher was responsible for his death. Can you imagine if such things happen? What would be our fate? Too terrific. Right? There are people who go to any extent. Okay? People who are very sensitive. People who do not have emotional intelligence. So that is where teacher's role comes to the picture, irrespective of what it is. That is where the people skills comes into the picture. You know, interpersonal skills. And there's a fine line, you know, when we talk about being friendly with a student and, you know, maintaining that decorum of being a strict teacher, right? So it's not that easy. It requires a lot of trial and error. You can't apply the same kind of policies or protocol what you were doing, which you were doing or, you know, performing in a classroom for quite some time. Now things have changed. Correct? One simple example. When we refer to written business communication, you know, people were very, very good once upon a time in writing. Today, writing skills have definitely taken a backseat because we find Gen Y is not that good readers. They do not have the patience to sit and read. Correct? When you take up the blue books for corrections, I'm sure that you will find a lot of SMS lingo and slang. SMS lingo, which I cannot understand. I don't know about you because some of you are very young. Maybe you can connect, but sometimes I cannot connect with what is the word he or she has written. There are so many words which has become accepted in the corporate language. Like say for example, ASAP, ASAP, as soon as possible. It's accepted. FYI, for your information. But LOL is not still accepted, luckily. Laughing out loud, it is only on the timeline of your Facebook. What I'm trying to tell you is, even for that matter, the organizations have stooped down to the Gen Y's level. They have not said, okay, we do have our own protocol while writing an email and we do not want people to practice colloquialism, slang and SMS because we have overseas clients also with us. Having said that, today when you find so much of paradigm shift in the thought process of Gen Y, they have opened up and accepted few words, meaning what? They have also become, you know, keen on building that synergy, which is very important, right? So as teachers or as professionals, it becomes very important for us to nurture people's skills. And many times what requires the most is a strong intrapersonal skills. The way, you know, we inculcate the mindfulness. The way we take care of our thinking process. Because at the end of the day, even we are human beings. Please understand. We have not fallen from heaven. We also have a family. We also have spoiled brats at home, we also have handful of work, we also have in-laws, we also have faced the traffic jams, we also have electricity bill and water bill to be paid. It's horrible. So emotions, frustrations are a byproduct for all of us. Having said that, we play a very important, crucial role of playing with the young minds and body and spirit. Right? That is where people's skills comes into the picture. I mean, when we refer to organizations, they have their own protocol, you know, where we talk about internal communication and external communication, how they communicate with their internal stakeholders and external stakeholders. However, with us as teachers, for us, it's very, very important to ensure that we learn, relearn and unlearn certain behavioral patterns. You know, the focus is more on behavior. For us, then let us think about fine-tuning our students. Okay, now let us have a quick experience, experiential learning. I would request out there, because there are two people in every chair, you know, every bench or whatsoever. Can you just give me an example of how you deal with your students? Good experience, bad experience. Take time to think and then. Otherwise, it won't become a proactive and interactive session. Anything. I'm not keen on PPTs alone. I can share the PPTs. That's not a big deal. You know, the intention is to have some takeaway from the session. Any kind of experience. Don't say we do not have experience at all. If you've never had an experience, you'll be never seated here. Anything. But every team should have something to say. You can take time to think. How we dealt with students. We had got, just an example. We had caught a boy copying the examination. We had to debar him. But then he was so nervous and we had a fear that what if he commits suicide. So how did you handle the situation? We are not talking about rules. We are not talking about protocol. We are simply talking about how do you deal with people's emotions. How do you deal with behavioral issue? Because that's all. That's what we term it as people's skills. That is what it's, you know, interpersonal skills. Take time to discuss and come back. Yeah.
Just making them, you need to share few words or you need to talk, might be 10 minutes. It depends upon, again, student. Some student they catch very fast, means within 5 minutes they would be convinced and they won't think about that part,
yeah,
committing suicide and other. But some people are very sensitive, they require more of
People will never even show you any symptoms of committing suicide. They will be as normal as anybody.
Yeah, so they will take more time. That time you need to be a friend. You cannot be a boss that time. You cannot tell no, forcefully whatever you have done.
Okay. Do you have any such incidents, that is what? Any such incidents wherein you had to counsel people and bring them out of that issues?
Counseling means, we come across so many instances like that, but not related to the exam. Mm-hmm. It would be some other thing else. So yeah. Might be somebody else has done and like that person has come because they feel like, okay, we can go and approach that teacher. Mm-hmm. So they have discussed so many matters regarding that. And they were convinced. But it depends upon student again, how
exactly.
Much. Yeah.
Exactly.
So that we need to realize.
Yeah, I would want people to clap for the first one to break eyes. I think clap loudly, there's no harm. Please clap loudly. Yeah. See, this is a great example to say, tell you that we hesitate even to clap. As adults, if it were to be a classroom of kids, I'm sure I would have heard a roaring, thunderous applause. So this is a clear example. Okay. Let me tell you the other side of the story. If you clap for somebody, nobody will raise up in the position. But it will open your energy chakras. Seriously. You know, according to pranic healing, it's not a joke. It's very important when you clap. It definitely opens the energy chakra. So if you're carrying any kind of phlegm, cough, you know, if you had any kind of virus in your body, it gives a chance at least for the virus to come out, at least in that brief period of 30 seconds or whatsoever, energy chakras gets opened up. It's very important. So see, this exercise was given intentionally to say that we do not follow mindfulness. I'm sorry to say that most of us get stuck in an artificial loop. It's an artificial loop. We create an artificial loop and sit there. As a result, we are not ready to break free from the shackles of our behavior, our attitude, personality. We feel that, I think I know better, I think I have experienced a lot, I know what I'm doing. Okay? See, you know, when Zig Ziglar put this word learn, relearn and unlearn, what he meant was, learn. We are in a knowledge era. You know, we are not fully accomplished. Let me tell you, there is a word called as VUCA, V-U-C-A, when we refer to the economy today. V stands for volatility, U stands for unambiguous situation, C stands for complexity, A again, ambidexterity and ambiguous situations. We have a very, very disintegrated economy. Any changes can happen. The best examples are innumerable mergers and acquisition happening. Okay. Public sectors getting converted into privatized companies. So many changes happening, right? We cannot always say that we are like this. That's the worst part. That is where we talk about changing our behavior patterns, which is very, very important. So if we are seated here with an intention of just for the heck of it, then I'm sure nothing changes. At the end of the day, at least when we say that, okay, let us make an attempt to change one quality what we have as an individual. For instance, some of us hesitate even to smile. We don't want to smile because the moment you smile, you feel that the student might think that I am a very, you know, friendly faculty. I don't want to smile, or you just want to carry your weightage whatsoever without smiling. Okay. Some of us always feel that let us always be very strict. Let us carry a different disposition, not a cheerful disposition. I mean, this sounds very artificial. Now, as a teacher, or for that matter, as a professional, it becomes very important for us to learn certain behavioral patterns, relearn them, and unlearn them. You know, we cannot say that this is what I am, this is the way I am. If you say that, it shows a rigid, glued mindset. It shows you are a failure, a personality which is not ready to break free from the shackles of glued mindset. When we refer to soft skills is nothing but change. Changing one's attitude, changing one's thinking process, changing one's personality. The very word personality, persona, is termed from a Greek word which means mask. All of us are wearing here a mask. We are not true to ourselves, right? That's the reason we have two, you know, pairs of clothing or attire. One set for a home front, another set for a workplace. Persona. We are wearing an artificial mask, right? Behavioral science time and again emphasizes on the fact that you have to break free from the shackles of your thought process. Why do you think, one simple question out of the blue, why do you think the same advertisements are shown every day? Why do you think the companies are pumping in so much of revenue for 30 seconds of advertisement? Boost is the secret of my energy. Every day you're seeing the same thing. What's the reason? Can somebody tell me here? You're all accomplished faculty.
Brand.
Huh?
Brand recall.
Sorry?
Recalling, brand recalling.
Okay, brand recalling. Okay, great. Okay, brand recalling. That's very hi-fi for me, man. So, that's a nice word, but yeah. Anything else?
To increase purchase.
Okay.
To attract your behavior.
Sorry?
To attract your behavior.
To attract the advertisement?
No, your attitude.
As a consumer. Consumer's behavior. Okay. What else?
To
persuade.
Okay.
Okay. What else? Because see, you're all accomplished faculty. I want to know the secret behind it. This is all correct. No doubt about it. Persuade, convince, influence the consumer behavior whatsoever. But there is a solid reason.
Because it sinks into our mind.
Okay.
It sinks into your mind. That this particular brand.
Excellent.
Right.
Please give a strong round of applause. Those who do not deserve. So, exactly. As somebody also said, you know, you recall it. Point is, it has got a subliminal messages in the science of psychology. Subliminal messages are, you know, when you look into the same advertisement, when you hear the same words, when you hear the same language, it just sinks into your subconscious mind without your knowledge.
Unknowingly.
Yes, unknowingly. And it remains there. And next time you go to buy a product and it just, you recall it, the attention span is so fast, then you pick that particular product. That's how it happens. It's called a subliminal messages. So again, we are focusing on what? We are focusing on intrapersonal. We are focusing on self-awareness. We are focusing on psyche, the mind. So that is where we as individuals have to break free from the shackles of our attitude, behavior, personality. And we are into teaching. We are not operating a computer. We are not operating the software. And we are in a knowledge era. Things are moving. It's not a snail-paced time anymore. Things are moving in leaps and bounds. At this point in time, if we do not change, we become dinosaurs. What happened to dinosaurs? All of us know, right?
Extinct.
Extinct. They remain fossils. Dinosaurus, which was a mammoth, huge animal, could not survive. Whereas our dear, creepy, crawly cockroach survived. According to research, if there is a nuclear fission and the entire Homo sapiens are wiped away from the face of the universe, still the cockroach will survive to tell the tale. A simple example. In case if you have cockroaches at home, especially kitchen being the den for cockroaches, switch off the light after 30 seconds, come back, you'll see a party happening. Uncle, aunts, cousins, kitten, kids, boyfriends and girlfriends. The moment you switch on the light, they all simply dash. Vanish into thin air, you can't find them. And in case if you find one and you wanted to kill it and you put your pressure on it and unfortunately it does not die, it falls flat, it pretends as if it is dead. Pretends. It has not come to Garden City College and attended any soft skill programs on diplomacy and tact. It just remains there without even budging an inch. After 30 seconds, slowly moves its antenna, moves its hands or legs whatsoever and tries to topsy-turvy. Comes out of its topsy-turvy position and in case if it feels that there is no external harm, tries to run away. Nature has inbuilt soft skills for it and it will survive to tell the tale. They can survive agility and versatility of cockroaches. They can survive in the refrigerators, oven, cupboard, anywhere. Please understand that. Whereas a huge dinosaurs could not. Why? Learn, relearn, unlearn. Right? I'm not talking about behavior. I'm talking about, you know, the diplomacy, tact. Why again? I can give you an example. These, if you look into the examples of animals, all this is picked and used in psychology. Psychology is a multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary science of management, anything under the sun. You pick any subject, the bottom line is psychology. Correct? So, you will find all the examples in psychology being based on animals. Why? Great examples and nobody can defy it. Classical conditioning, you talk about animals, the dog salivating, Pavlov's classical conditioning, B.F. Skinner's operant conditioning, rats being used, right? Animals are considered to be very, very strong, very, very shrewd, very, very, you know, agile and versatile. So, as human beings, so-called indispensable, undisputable Homo sapiens, if we do not learn the tactics of relearning, unlearning, learning, breaking free from the shackles of our mindset, behavioral pattern, personality, no people skills will happen. No change will happen. We will become dinosaurs very soon. Why do you think that there are so many divorces happening today? I'm not saying that it's only because of lack of adjustment, not that. But majorly, compatibility has become null and void. Himalayan-sized ego. Friction and ego. A small brick is enough for the whole thing to clash, whole thing to come down. We take up a lot of projects in IMHANS and we do marital counseling. We will be shocked many times to find that they never have a problem at all. They are very keen on divorce. Many times, many marriages go, you know, apart because of ego clashes, frictions. I am not saying that is the only reason, but most of the time this is a solid reason. And we said the better about the Gen Y, love at first sight, marriage at second sight in case if marriage happens and divorce at third sight. You would have seen many times, you know, in the campus you would have seen that this girl and boy, they were very close. After a couple of years you will find the photograph of the girl on the Facebook with all red chudiya, but the boy is somebody else. Look at the audacity to put the pictures. When the whole world knew that you had a living relationship with the man, with this particular man, that's how the world is moving. You cannot say that...
That is interpersonal skill?
No, definitely not.
Definitely not. According to the mean of the time, that is also interpersonal skill.
How? Can you elaborate? It's nice you are speaking.
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me, how do you feel?
Because they were in the mean of the time and she has changed. She has married certain...
Excellent.
That's the need of the time.
Exactly.
We cannot question.
Yeah.
In your time, you may be questioning 20,
yes.
30 years back.
Yes.
But now that's accepted. Interpersonal skill, like the cockroach.
Yeah.
And survive.
Yes. You're right. The reason what I'm trying to tell you here, the example of change is, I'm trying to tell you that politically, economically, sociologically, technologically, the world is changing. We are moving in leaps and bounds. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Pick any example. You'll find that 20 years back, what was disgusted or what was not accepted today is accepted at any cost. Things are changing. You cannot say that, no, I'm not going to change. Then you will become a dinosaur. That's the reason he said that, yes, she was more like a cockroach. That's the reason she adapted and survived. That shows agility and versatility. Absolutely.
Yes.
But there are other factors also to it. You know, when you go in depth, you find that though we talked about interpersonal skills here, when she displays a photograph with some other man, she's inviting a lot of trouble too. That goes as a different story altogether. What I'm trying to tell you here is, things have changed, things are moving. It's contemporary times. And it's high time when you talk about so many changes that's happening in the ecosystem. Why can't we change? That is what I'm trying to tell you. Nothing more than that. Why can't, you know, we change our behavioral patterns? Why can't we change our rude mindset? That's all I'm trying to tell you.
But
I'm not trying.
Always it's not possible.
Yeah,
always it's not possible.
Absolutely. Always
if
it is not possible.
If you change always, then
yeah.
Your personality is fluctuating.
Very true.
We
see,
have to determine somewhere.
See, we talk about antecedent behavior, consequences, and decision. We call this an A, B, C, D factor.
But in certain matter, we can change.
Absolutely.
We can proceed.
Yes. See,
but
that is what I'm telling you.
Somewhere we have to stand.
Yes.
Without taking a stand, we can't proceed.
Absolutely. That is why I said antecedent. When I say antecedent, see, you have your own antecedents. Like, no, I don't want to change here. Because once I change here, people will take me for granted.
Mm-hmm.
So, but antecedent will lead to your behavior. That behavior will lead to a consequence, A, B, C consequences. That consequences will lead to a decision. You take a different decision. Everything relates on an antecedent. Your experience, your feeling. And you as an adult know that. Should I change here or should I not change here?
Yeah.
Correct?
Somewhere we have to determine.
Yes. That somewhere is common sense.
Yeah.
And that common sense is not that common. We say common sense. It's all common sense. But my second question is common sense so very common? No, it is not. That is the reason we are seated here in the session. And I'm not saying I'm an expert on behavioral science. Never. As you rightly said, there are a lot of, interactions that happens from different kinds of people. And you will sometimes feel that there's no need for me to change. The situation is different from the other. Okay. So by and large, when we talk about interpersonal skills, you know, to tie up all this fine thread or connect dots, I'll come back to you. I was just trying to tell you that interpersonal skill is a byproduct. Intrapersonal is nothing but your personality traits. And these personality traits are like a DNA. They are a part and parcel of your blood cells. And it becomes very difficult for us to change as adult, though there are so many changes in the ecosystem. That's the reason I gave them all these examples to say that there are a lot of changes happening. And we as professionals believe that, no, this is the way we are, right? And many a times we are not in a position to change or compromise. Yes, ma'am.
The reason for divorce, the rates have increased, what I feel is, the previous generation used to forgive the person and live happily thereafter.
Okay.
Now they forget the person and live happily thereafter.
Okay. Yes.
So that's
yes.
What I feel. There is
yes.
A lot of difference
absolutely.
Between forgiving and forgetting the...
Yeah. So where do you bracket that forgiving and forgetting? Where do you bracket that? Under interpersonal or intrapersonal?
Intrapersonal.
That is leading to inter. Correct? You are right, interpersonal. So that is what I am trying to tell you. Once upon a time we were ready for compromise, we were ready for adjustment. Today people are not that ready.
Used to.
Yes. Correct. What does that indicate? That indicates that the intrapersonals have changed drastically. There is a paradigm shift. Right? And it's going to change. Imagine your grandchildren. You are a young girl. So I'm talking about your grandchildren. She will walk out of the house if somebody asks her to make a cup of coffee and tell you.
Now
things will change.
No one is coming.
Exactly. Now itself you find all government changes happening. So, you know, changes are bound to happen. We are in a world where things are moving in leaps and bounds. Don't think that very soon you will be buying a site in Mars, or you will be building a mansion on Moon. That's fine. However, yes.
Why changes is happening in negative side only? That they will not follow. They
See, there are controllable and uncontrollable factors. Correct. Controllable factors are certain things that can be controlled in terms of judiciary, legislative, protocol, whatsoever. Uncontrollable factors, we do not have an answer for.
We can't say all.
The whole world is like that. The whole world is moving. You are asking me why the sun is coming in the daytime, why not in the night? I am trying to tell you that sun will come only in the daytime, moon will come in the night. Meaning, there are controllable and uncontrollable factors. There are few things which is not under our control. And we do not have an answer for it, irrespective of what kind of arguments we do, irrespective of the intellectual inertia we have, whatsoever. Pick any example, a social evil or a modern contemporary practice, anything you pick. Certain things are under control. We can control them. Certain things are under irrespective of what it is. You have witnessed so many things happening in the society.
No, you can't say all young men will change. It is not all high fingers are same. Some will change, depend on our sanskar also.
Absolutely. No, absolutely. That is what is happening today also, right? Changes are happening, but not everybody is moving with that time.
It is up to us.
It is up to us.
But the thing is, if you see the young generation, more of negative thoughts are there in their mind because of so many problems what they are facing. They have so many problems.
And they have a lot of exposure.
Yeah.
What we did not have. I'm talking to
you. We should change them now.
How?
No. It is difficult. You need to slightly change.
It is not difficult.
Okay. We are not, these things are not. That's what, again, I'm telling you. It's an uncontrollable thing. See, like, for instance, okay, you have something to say.
Slowly, when they will get mature, slowly they will change.
Yeah.
Now they.
Yeah, that's a positive belief. That's where we believe in open faith.
Consequence of interpersonal and interpersonal.
Absolutely. Everything in the world starts from individuals. See, for instance, I don't have something to write, otherwise I would have shown you. An organization. You talk about an organization. Organization consists of groups and teams. Groups and teams consist of individuals. So you look at the pyramid, I, G, and O. I go with the organization. Okay. If I don't go with the organization, it's a misfit. So everything boils down to an individual. First individual, then groups and teams, then the organization. Organization is not just an infrastructure, it's made up of people, like you and I, right? So everything boils down to an individual. So individual, when we refer to an individual, intrapersonal. Correct? So what I am trying to tell you is, when we refer to the word interpersonal, it is not a separate entity. It is a byproduct of intrapersonal. Intrapersonal consists of few components like self-awareness, self-management, self-motivation, self-regulation, empathy, very important. I don't put myself in your position, and neither you. We don't empathize with each other. How do you think we can have interpersonal skills? For interpersonal skills, empathy is very important, right? Similarly, we don't listen. That's why I gave an example of children and adults. We hear meaning bits and pieces. We don't listen. And we don't accept feedback. Very important for interpersonal skills. Feedback, I'm not talking about our students who are giving the feedback, not that. Feedback from our peer group, feedback from our seniors, feedback from anybody. If somebody gives a good feedback, we fly in the seventh heaven, cloud nine. When somebody gives something, I think you are not that good. Oh, she's jealous of me. That's the reason she gave me. I'm telling you, I'm not talking about children. I'm talking about adults. Constructive feedback. Very important. Because each individual is different. As you rightly said, all the five fingers are not alike. Each one of us are different. Having said that, if we have to work on interpersonal skills, there are a few components that has to be taken care of. First is intrapersonal. When we refer to intrapersonal, we refer to self-awareness. Self-awareness talks about what? Everything. EQ and IQ. Once upon a time, managers were recruited only for IQ. Intelligent quotient. Today, EQ, RQ, SQ. EQ is emotional quotient. RQ is relationship quotient. SQ is spiritual quotient. Right? So many things have come into picture. Emotional intelligence. Daniel Goldman's book is superb. You should read that. It talks about how important for an individual intrapersonal skills are. So if you practice mindfulness, that is why we said mindfulness. Conscious and deliberate approach of knowing what to think. Okay, I don't want to start with the negative thoughts. Let me think about something positive. That's mindfulness.
Ma'am.
Yes.
I have a question.
Please.
Madam, your soft skill class and this intrapersonal and interpersonal.
Yeah.
Please clear me that how it will help me to increase the attendance of my student to the class. The attendance is very poor. I'm not happy.
Controllable, uncontrollable factors. Okay? Which subject you understand?
I teach about cuisines, how to prepare different cuisines for
special. It should be really very interesting. Okay, management.
But they are not coming to class. College started on 15th. No student today. So I am very serious.
Correct. You are right.
So I thought this class will help.
This class might not help you out because, as I told you, controllable and uncontrollable factors. This falls on uncontrollable factors for various reasons. Why? Because maybe these guys had no interest in cuisine, somebody has pushed them to take hotel management and they have landed up. Okay? So they are for the heck of it, they are coming, they have got a lot of money, they just to get the degree, they are coming down. Okay? Second, if there is any hardcore regulation, 75% attendance or 85% attendance, then it will work out. Third, if there is something like no fine system, we are not going to take any fine because most of the guys will say, I'll bunk the class at the end of the day, I'll pay some money and get it to them. I'll take 6 hours.
There is no fine.
So if they say that, we are not going to take any fine. We will work only on attendance. If your attendance is not on par with whatever has been, proclaimed by the organization, by the college, then you will be debarred. You will be not given exam. If something stringent rules are put around, I think you can work on it. And when you refer to cuisine, you can also make the course interesting by thinking of innovative approaches. What do? Out of the blue, I'm asking. You might be very keen on covering the portions and, if you can bring some innovative, I'll just give you an example. We have a lot of chefs, like who's this person's name? Darla Dalal. Then we have Sanjeev Kapoor. Why don't you bring the videos of these guys and bring interesting cuisine once in a week? Why don't you ask those guys to come up with a cook without fire?
We do all this thing. We do all this thing.
You do all this. Yes.
In spite of that, I don't.
Lot of PPTs. I am not keen to show you PPT. I can give you that PPT. The intention was to make people think, question oneself, argue with me and throw your points across. Okay? It is not my opinion. I have picked up from the research what the contemporary behaviorists believe and I am trying to share my little knowledge in terms of soft skills. And the only module which I picked up is interpersonal, and I can strongly tell you that interpersonal skills are a byproduct of intrapersonal. Intrapersonal consists of all this: self-awareness, self-management, self-regulation, self-motivation, empathy. Very important. And another important aspect as individuals, we need to believe in the component of learning, relearning and unlearning. We should come out of our perception and most of the time we should compare and contrast with either children or animals. Because there is a lot of innocence writ large on the faces of children and the learning process is very, very sincere when we compare ourselves, adult learning process and the child-oriented learning process. As teachers, we are in fact privileged to work with the mind and spirit of young people and we are in a very, very challenging environment today, where things are moving in fast leaps and bounds. At this point in time, if we do not cope up with the changes, then we will bound to become dinosaurs, we will become extinct. So updating oneself, keeping open for feedback. Somebody criticizes us, definitely we might feel bad, we might feel hurt, no problem. But then taking some time to do a bit of self-introspection. Why didn't he or she make this kind of sarcastic remark? Okay, maybe 10% even I was on the wrong side, definitely can help out in becoming better. And another important thing is, charity begins at home. Let us inculcate the habit of having people's skills at home front. Let us digest our better halves, Let us take into consideration our in-laws. Let us give respect to our children. Let us have a sense of tolerance in the home front. And let us practice this mindfulness. Okay? Once we do this mindfulness, a conscious and deliberate approach of what to think, how to react. See, there's a difference between the word react and respond. We will not react, we will respond. We will try to create this mindfulness for responding. Okay, then probably we might improvise in terms of our people skills. And no matter whether you sit here and listen to 101 lectures, it's not that easy to shed the inhibitions of an individual. It takes time for us to change, right? Sometimes we won't change. Sometimes throughout our lives we are like this, you know, we remain in artificial cocoon. But when we call ourselves as teachers, when we say that we are professionals, it's very, very important for us to change. That is what I have had in my mind. In fact, I've got a lot of inputs, but I don't think it's worth sharing because you're all on par with me. Okay? So if you have anything to put it across, you can give it to me at this point in time. I will definitely take it from this classroom as a learning for myself. Thank you so much for your patience, for your cheerful disposition, and making this Saturday a fruitful one for me. Thank you so much.